2015.
The Interception Bills Committee on Interception of Communications and Surveillance, amended Bill 2015, is now called to order. This is the 10th meeting. We have a quorum, and we've reached the appointed time. We will continue the close study of the bill. Last time, we stopped at page 10 of the markup copy of the Chinese version. All right, I'll hand over the floor to the officials. Please, get the ball rolling. This is Section 27, Determination of Application for Confirmation, Prescribed Authorization or Renewal Issued or Granted Upon Oral Application. On page 10 of the Chinese version, this is an amendment to Section 27 of the ordinance, and this is to implement the recommendation by Justice Wu. And that's in relation to determination of application for confirmation of prescribed authorization or renewal issued or granted upon oral application. Additional conditions can be added. Now, that refers to an emergency authorization. In respect of refusal, or in respect of determination of for the confirmation of oral application, it's not just to confirm or not, it also gives the power to the panel judges to add conditions. Therefore, you can see the arrow and any new conditions under 27.3A2. There is an additional provision 3A under 27, and that's in relation to the oral application or renewal or confirmation of prescribed authorization. These are further provisions or further conditions. We are asked to look into the term further authorization. We are now preparing a written reply. The wording is consistent with Section 32 of the ordinance. The drafting therefore follows that. But we will give a written reply and then we can engage in further discussion on this. Mr. James Toe, I have a question concerning 3A2, Roman 2. Does it mean a refusal or rejection or not? Mrs. Ng. Thank you, Chairman. Mr. Tao. Under 3, where the relevant authority refuses to confirm. Under A2. The original application for confirmation is refused, but it can be effective after the conditions are added. The whole application can be rejected, or under 2, the conditions can be changed, and then the authorization can continue then. Now, under 3A1 is refusal, revoke. Some 3A2 is not revocation, and that is only a variation. Doesn't variation mean variation of conditions or variation with conditions? Why? Can't you call it a variation instead of calling it new conditions, only to have effect subject to the variations? And it can only be effective subject to the variations. And these are the conditions. Is it a purely drafting issue? Or is there a difference in legal sense between variations and conditions? According to the ex-commissioner, Justice Wu, is of the view that variation refers to the terms. Say the application is for a 3-day operation, maybe 5 days. The authority can vary the term from 5 days instead of from 5 days to 3 days instead. And that is a change, a variation. The former commissioner said that there was no provision for new conditions attached, and he asked for putting in such a provision. Therefore, we do it out of respect for the former commissioner. So you're worried that variation bars the authority from adding new conditions. You add any new conditions. Is it really new condition or subject to any conditions? The conditions may not be new. Should the word is the word new redundant? Shouldn't it be just any conditions? Yes, Mr. James Toh. Originally, there was no condition, and in this place, when the confirmation is refused, here it is given the power to the commissioner to add new conditions. You mean that variations of old terms, if the terms are there, then you vary it. It's called a variation, but if it is a new condition, then you call it a new condition, because there was none. Now, according to Section 32, prescribed authorization can include a prescribed authorization with conditions. Under 2.1, that includes emergency authorization or covert surveillance, authorization for covert surveillance. Authorization can include certain conditions. I think the commissioner is of the view that variation may not include the meaning of new conditions. Variation means the changing of the original terms and conditions, whereas that may not mean adding new conditions. Therefore, amendment is necessary to avoid any doubt or to remove any doubt, so that the panel judge may vary the terms, the existing terms, or add new conditions. That is to give wider power to the panel judge. The suggestion, any new conditions, was it raised by the commissioner? This is would you clarify this? Is it a proposal by the former commissioner? Yes, the proposal is from the former commissioner, and the powers to be given to the panel judge. Yes, indeed, Chairman, the proposal was raised by the former commissioner, as said by Mr. Khan, under Section 32. Prescribed authorization includes oral authorization, and that can be a renewal, and in issuing a renewal, conditions can be imposed. And in providing the confirmation, new conditions can be added, and existing that is to be distinguished from the original conditions. Now my question is, this question is about 3A. With regard to further authorization, does it mean that in the future it will be decided by another judge? You don't need to apply for further authorization. And now if you go to the judge again, whether it's a renewal, the judge can consider adding what sort of conditions. Now, would you reduce the power of the judge because of this provision? Yes, Mrs. Ng. We did discuss this previously. Probably, Mr. Toh was not present. Oh, I wasn't present, I believe. With regard to further authorization, it was put down in the ordinance, not with the view of time. It was in respect of additional authorization, such as those in sections 29 and 30. It was ancillary. Mr. Sin Chung Kai and Mr. Po Che asked us to look at the wording more carefully, and we will provide a written reply to the members. Under 3A, A and B, further authorization refers to 20 and 30, right? Sections 20 and 30. Can you specify more clearly specifying it as with reference to sections 29 and 30? Last time, Mr. Sin Chung Kai raised the same point. Chairman, it shows that everybody finds this unclear. I have not discussed that with Mr. Sin Chung Kai. That's okay. Everybody has to be very serious and careful about reading the bills. Yes, Mr. Sin Chung Kai, I want to respond to this. Now, the PAS said that she would give a written reply. I have looked at it more carefully. Today, the story is replayed. Whether you read the Chinese and or English version, you come to the same conclusion. You make the same mistake. How can you make sure that the judge will not do the same? So you really need to consider the drafting. I'm not from the law drafting profession, but even those from the legal profession find the same reading. So the present wording is problematic. Well, let us await the reply of the administration. The administration will adhere to the original expression. Yes, 3A. Now concerning the last bracket, why you need the brackets? You mean whether granted or imposed under the terms of the blah blah blah? Well, having read that, I really don't know what it is saying. Well, PAS, can you tell us what does it mean? This is to explain the further authorization or requirement. As for those in the brackets, according to understanding, it can whether granted or imposed under the terms of the prescribed authorization or renewed prescribed authorization of any provision of this ordinance. Now, this is referring to sections 29 and 30. This is to clarify the whole issue.
This kind of drafting follows exactly the present section 32. Well, okay, let me try to figure this out first. You mentioned any provision. And by any provision, you mean sections 29 and 30. What about granted or imposed? That is the first part. And then or renewed, that's the second part. What are these? Is it that they are not needed here? Because by having granted or renewed, you are already stating what I'm talking about. It can even be A. Do you get the question? Maybe Mr. Can attempt an answer. Senior Assistant Solicitor General from the DOJ, Mr. Can. Thank you, Chairman. Three capital A states in English, actually, it means emergency authorization. So here it says further authorization or requirement under the prescribed authorization or renewed prescribed authorization. We are talking about the authorization by the same panel judge. If it is an authorization by a panel judge for covert surveillance or interception, or depending which kind it is, then the sections 29 or 30 would automatically authorize the LEAs. But if the panel judge would like to prescribe the exercise or invoking of sections 29 or 30 by LEAs, he can set these conditions. In other words, the panel judge can prescribe what is granted under prescribed authorization. He can also invoke sections 29 and 30 to prescribe the conditions. And here it is just to make it even clearer. Mr. Toh, sorry, I still don't get it. Well, if you don't think there is a problem, so be it. I just find it very difficult to understand. Maybe you try to read it and comprehend it further. Okay, if there are no other questions, let's go to the next page where there is no amendment. Let us go to page 9 of the English version. Section 38, device retrieval warrant may be issued subject to conditions. PAS. Thank you, Chairman. On page 9 of the English version, this is clause 9 of the bill to amend section 38 of the ordinance, which is about device retrieval warrant may be issued subject to conditions. This is again a proposal by the former CICS. The CICS was aware that in the ordinance, under such a section, there is no revocation mechanism. It's just like in other sections where there is not a partial revocation mechanism. Let me explain a little. What is meant by a device retrieval warrant? It is issued by the panel judge and it can be applied for by LEAs. When a prescribed authorization action has lapsed, in other words, there is no operation going on, the operation has ended, and so if the LEA still holds certain device and it is left at a certain place, and if the device is not retrieved before the operation is ended, then it can apply to the panel judge for a device retrieval warrant, which will be granted according to the ordinance. We are adding 38 capital A on the right to state the conditions under which LEAs have to file a report to panel judges who can consider and revoke the warrant. According to previous CICS reports, actually two CICS, there has never been any application for retrieving devices. This is really to perfect the mechanism under the ordinance. Let me now talk about the content of this amendment. 38 capital A, revocation of device retrieval warrant. In the first part, it says if while a device retrieval warrant is in force, but not yet completely executed, the officer of the department concerned, who is for the time being in charge of the execution of the warrant, A, becomes aware that Section 33(1)(a) or B does not apply to the devices or any of the devices specified in the warrant, or B, is of the opinion that the warrant or a part of the warrant cannot for whatever reason be executed, then the officer must, as soon as reasonably practicable, after becoming aware of the matter or forming the opinion, cause a report on the matter or opinion to be provided to a panel judge. Now, what do we mean by A? What conditions are we talking about? It invokes 33(1)(a) or B. It actually means when the officer becomes aware that the device is not at the place for which it has been applied. In other words, he knows the device is not there, or that the device has been lost and the officer doesn't know where it is, then he has to report to the panel judge. B, if the warrant cannot be executed or any part of it cannot be executed, say for example the premises have been set on fire and everything is lost, that is disaster, then he also has to report to the panel judge that the device retrieval warrant cannot be executed anymore. This is bracket 1. Bracket 2. If a panel judge receives a report, the panel judge may revoke the device retrieval warrant concerned or the relevant part of the warrant concerned. Number 3. If the device retrieval warrant or a part of it has been revoked, the warrant or that part of the warrant despite Section 35B ceases to have effect from the time of the revocation. 35B states the duration of the warrants, but in here it says there will be no regard for 35B. Once it is revoked under this section, it will become invalid. Number 4. If the warrant is not revoked, only part of it is revoked, the panel judge may vary the terms or conditions of the warrant, or B, specify any new conditions in the warrant that apply to the warrant itself or to any further authorization under it. This was what we were discussing just now. Our written reply will also cover 4B because it tackles the same discussion that we had just now. I think I'll stop here. Sin Chung Kai, and then James To, and then Wong Yok Man. I have a general question first. The issue of device retrieval warrant with conditions, will the panel judge also state the validity of the warrant? PAS? According to Section 35, the validity of device retrieval warrants is prescribed when the panel judge issues the warrant becomes valid, and during the validity, it is valid, but then when the validity period ends, it will lapse or be revoked, and the validity period cannot be longer than 3 months. In other words, it will be stated by the panel judge, and the longest validity period is 3 months. Any other questions? I will wait. Mr. James To, Chairman. (38A) is a new clause. My understanding is that it is to complete Section 38? Or is it that you don't have to have regard for Section 38? Well, I don't think so. I think it must be based on 38. In 38, you already have the words subject to conditions. Well, I don't know, but would it mean that if, say, it is an interception device and if there is still battery power, you don't have to retrieve it, and if the battery has died, you won't be able to intercept communication anymore, so it doesn't have to be retrieved? I don't know, I'm just asking, would that happen? PAS. Thank you, Chairman. As I said, throughout all these years after the ordinance has come in force, the LEAs have not applied for any such warrants, so there are no cases for reference in the CICS's reports. But according to a former CICS, his worry is that you ask panel judges to issue device retrieval warrants. But if it is not executed, the LEA doesn't have to come back to tell the panel judge. This has never happened, but this is a proposal by a former CICS, and we agree with him. When LEAs cannot execute a warrant, the LEAs should go back and report to the panel judge. So we have accepted the proposal and have come up with this amendment. But Chairman, I'm actually concerned that since the ordinance has come into force for a few years already and no one has applied for retrieving the warrants or has applied for the retrieval warrants. Say I'm really thinking about interception devices, etc. In other words, right now, the police can install all these devices and they will not retrieve them. No, my understanding is that they should not be left there. No, if you have installed them, they can be removed. No, now if you want to retrieve it, you have to act according to Section 38. I'd like to clarify this. Is it that no one has made any application under 38? Chairman and Mr. To, let me answer the question. Indeed, there has never been any application for device retrieval warrant as stated in the reports of the CICS over the years. But this section is about a situation where at the end of an operation, if the device is not retrieved or cannot be retrieved, then you apply for the warrant. When you apply for this warrant, the operation has ended. The LEAs need to do this only when the operation is over. In other words, an operation was conducted within the period allowed, and the devices have been retrieved after the operation has ended. So there has not been a case where the devices have been left there after an operation has ended. Well, this is your answer now. But have you asked all the LEAs that they have not applied for any warrants under 38 because of what you are saying? Please do not just imagine what should have happened, because I can think of another possibility. They will just say, I am not listening in to it already. It's just that the transmission goes on and then other people can tune into the same frequency and tap into the communication. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Well, the government has already said that no such warrants have been applied for. Chairman, maybe I can put it this way. We read the CICS's report. We have never seen the application for such warrants. But if you have read all those reports, the CICS surveillance may not be only covert surveillance, he also tracks the devices.
He was very keen on whether after the operation the devices went back to the device register. He checked at what time the device was used, at what time the device was returned. And when there was the returning of the device, there might be some mistakes. That might be, say, a wrong filling in of the form, for example. It was an audio device, and then the return was put in an optical device register. And that was mentioned by the commissioner. The commissioner did not just let it go. He followed the arrangement very carefully, and everything had to be accountable. I can recall that in a certain part had fallen out and it was unable to be retrieved, and it was openly mentioned in the report. And Mr. James, so I ask this question and then I'll cue again. I hope that you will not just interpret the report of the commissioner and then explain your interpretation to me and said that it was your understanding. Now, there was no application under Section 38. Can you confirm that it was, what were the reasons for the absence of application under Section 38? When I scrutinized Section 38, I read Section 38 at that time when I studied the bill before it was enacted. Now, I thought that it would be a very expensive device, say, for example, something installed on the ceiling. It was very expensive. It was public money, paid by public money after evidence was collected. It had to be retrieved because it was a lot of money. You had to enter into the premises, and therefore, secretly, therefore, you had to rely on Section 38. Maybe with the progress of technology, everything is very cheap, just a few $100s, just write it off as wastage. But under certain conditions, the device may be switched on again. Maybe a worker just switch it on inadvertently, and those living nearby can tune in at the right frequency and then can hear everything. Now, can you confirm what Mr. Toh said? Mr. Khan, if you look at Section 38, it's very clear that the prescribed authorization includes the authorization of certain acts, such as retrieval of any device under that prescribed authorization. Within the prescribed authorization period, if a law enforcement agency has completed the operation, it has the power to retrieve the device. And if the device has been retrieved within the validity of the authorization, there is no need to make any application under Section 33, nor is there any need for a device retrieval warrant. I'm referring to Section 38, not 33. Now, can you confirm? We can give a written confirmation to Mr. Toh. Okay, that's safer. Mr. Wong Yong-man. Thank you, Chairman. Just now, Mr. Toh raised a question. I hope the administration will give a definite reply. This is really a problem. As for Section 38A, in comparison with the original 38, device retrieval warrant may be issued subject to conditions. But 38A, revocation of device retrieval warrant, it will lead to some misreading. In particular in Chinese. This is just the Chinese version can read differently. Device retrieval warrant is a term. Revocation is The revoke is a verb. I think you really need to tidy up your Chinese version. Secondly, the questions are, or rather the sentences are very long and you have not improved upon it. Now there can be misunderstanding. Yes, this is a good point. I think you better tidy it up. Will you take that into account? Will you consider that? Yes, certainly, we'll consider that. English is revocation of device, retrieval warrant. Don't speak English with me. This is the Chinese version. There can be misunderstanding if you read the Chinese. Yes, I think she agrees with you. Yes, please go back and think about it. Mr. Wong. Ms. Claudia Mo. Thank you, Chairman. Just now, the point in relation to the Chinese version is exactly the way they put it in English. The Chinese version, as long as it reads, is really causing misunderstanding. Now, just now, in answering James Toh's question, you give people the impression that the warrant, the devices, had not been left behind and they were all retrieved. And then, gradually, you said that something had fallen out and could not be retrieved. I don't understand what you mean by something had fallen out. What has fallen out and what do you mean by that? I recalled that there was such a case. Maybe I can provide a written reply on the details of that case. Something fallen out. Had it fallen into the sea? Well, there was a reference to this incident. Something fell, something lost, out of the loop, or something lost. Or a drop from a height? What do you mean? Well, we'll give a reply to that. With regard to 3A1B, he's of the opinion that the warrant or part of the warrant cannot, for whatever reason, be executed. There is a good example. Say, for example, the premises had a fire, everything was burned down. There was nothing to retrieve. Now, if it was burned down, there was nothing to retrieve. You cannot retrieve that. You cannot dispose of it. But can you give us a more common situation for the inability to execute the warrant, or partly unable to be executed? Yes, Chairman, thank you. With regard to 38A1AB, A refers to the situation in which the whereabouts of the device is not known. Say, for example, the device has been installed, but without the knowing of the law enforcement agency, people take away all the furniture, all the objects from the premises. And police or the law enforcement agencies do not know the whereabouts of the device, and therefore there's a need to report to the judge. As a B, it may be the result of fire or flood or in an extreme situation. The building is not the premises are not accessible because the premises have been hoarded or sealed because they have become dangerous structure. Now, if you're not able to retrieve it, then you need to report to the judge why the warrant cannot be executed. That's a responsible act. Yes, okay. I'm satisfied with the answer. Mr. Paul Chair, with regard to 38A, or capital A, it seems that 1A, according to explanation, refers to the discrepancy between the device and the premises, and therefore, now there is a device, and the device is still there in the premises. Originally, if you relax the N, then you don't need to add 38A. The PS. A and B address different scenarios. B deals with the device, and nobody knows where the device is. When you apply for a warrant, you need to apply to tell the judge where the device is. But after the warrant has been given, you have found that the device is no longer there. Say, for example, they have been removed. It has been removed, or the device is attached to a subject, and that subject has been put in a landfill, and you cannot retrieve it. That's for as for B. For whatever reason, it cannot be executed. 33.1A and B. As for B, 33.1AB, you know where the you don't know where the device is. As for B, you know the warrant is. Well, you know where the device is, but for one reason or another, you will have no access to that place. So A. Can 38A1A refers to the situation in which you don't know where the device is, and B, the device is still there, but because of flood or fire or dangerous structure, you have no access, and therefore you need to revoke that. Now there is a 3-month period, validity period. You refer to the mischief of the original 33.1. It may be too restrictive, too specific. 38A deals with that, something which has not happened before. So, have you gone overboard? Are you suggesting an excessive address to that problem? Now the judge cannot give you a new warrant, and it can, and also the old warrant has a validity period, and after that it will expire. So is it really necessary to have 38A? The PS. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Chair. 38A.
时候咧，系一定要跟33.1A或者B 嘅条。
When the conditions are, or when the warrant is approved, the conditions are specified. And when the device is no longer there, then the LEA will have to report to the judge. B deals with other reasons, which are not related to 33.1AB. You just want to clarify this. 38A. 1A deals with the loss of the device. You better spell it out. When the device is lost, you don't need to beat around the bush. I have to find out under what circumstances 33.1AB are not applicable. You're really cracking a nut with a sledgehammer. Now I read the English first, after I read the Chinese. And if I cannot understand what they mean in the English version, then there must be a problem according to my training and experience. You're just cracking a nut with a sledgehammer.
Thank you, Chairman. I agree with Mr. Chair. Sometimes when we read the Chinese, we might find it convoluted and incomprehensible. This is what actually we want to avoid in drafting the law. We have heard you will go back and think again. But let me make one point. Under 38 capital A, we have consulted the incumbent CICS and Judge Saw, who just left the post. They both agreed that in order to perfect the mechanism of the ordinance, it's true that this has never happened in the 9 years before. They cannot predict what will happen future, so they agree that we have the construction as in 38A, but I agree language-wise, as also mentioned by Mr. Wang Yongman, he has drawn our attention to the Chinese writing, and we'll go back and see what can be done. Thank you. Mr. James To. Chairman, if 33, which has to do with the granting of a warrant, let's say after 3 months, you must retrieve it, right? You must retrieve the device. Is that a stipulation? Or is it that you don't have to do that if it is not a valuable item? So you just leave it there? What happens usually? Or else I cannot consider whether 38 and 38A are appropriate. I think Mr. Kan has written in to say that the device has to be retrieved. PAS. The device must be retrieved because in the entire regulatory regime, devices are given a lot of attention. No, I mean legally. Sorry, listen to me. Legally speaking, is there a condition now? Maybe I don't know the ordinance as much as you do. I'm not talking about the CICS report or his practice. I'm talking about the law. Is it that once you set a device, you also have to retrieve it? Mr. Kan, can you take up the question? Thank you, Chairman. I mentioned 33.1A. It authorizes LEAs to get the device, but it doesn't stipulate that the device has to be retrieved. However, the spirit of the entire ordinance is to protect privacy, and the CICS will have to make sure that the devices are not abused. Chairman, here I would first ask the government to start thinking about this. I think there is still time for you to further amend the clauses here. You must put a primary responsibility on LEAs to retrieve the devices. Or if you just rely on the CICS practice, it will be problematic. Rather, if under circumstance the device cannot be retrieved, then of course you report to the panel judge and then apply for permission not to retrieve the device. If there is no primary responsibility to retrieve the device, I think that can be dangerous. DS, I'd like to add, the LEAs, of course, have to act according to the law. The ordinance also stipulates that they have to act according to the code of practice. The code is not law, but contravention of the code amounts to contravention. And under the code, it says if the device is not retrieved after the authorization has ended, well, unless it is not practicable or reasonable, it has to be retrieved. And also, under all circumstances, when the authorization period ends, the officer in charge of the surveillance operation will have to take all reasonable steps to make sure the device ceases to operate, and also to ensure that there will not be any more transmission of signals using that device. This is a public document, and the LEAs follow this code very closely. I'd like to emphasize that we should not just look at the ordinance. Any flouting of the code can subject officers concerned to disciplinary action. Sorry, I find that answer unacceptable. If you can write it into the code, you should, in fact, be changing the law. You shouldn't say that there is a lower level regulation and you are happy with it. The law, of course, ranks above the code. I would ask the administration, therefore, to take the opportunity to add a CSA. It should be for you to do it because you can give it comprehensive consideration. You have to state that once a device is set up, it has to be retrieved. I understand there can be circumstances when the device cannot be retrieved, so you have to apply for not retrieving it. But under 38, you say you may apply for it to be retrieved. Now, why do you want to apply for it to be retrieved? Well, experience tells us, and also from other public reports of jurisdictions overseas, it may be because the LEA doesn't want people to know that the device is not retrieved, so the operation is exposed. And maybe the authorization period might have ended. So you have to make an application under 38. But I don't think that takes care of everything, because in fact, there is no primary responsibility for the device to be retrieved. I think that itself amounts to an infringement of privacy. Okay, I think your view is very clear. The administration, if you don't have a response now, you should consider it when you go back. Any response? DS, Chairman, we have heard Mr. Toh. We can cover that point in our written reply. We can give more information to Mr. Toh. Ms. Claudia Mo, thank you, Chairman. The administration has legal experts, but the code of practice is not legally binding. You say contravention of it can lead to punishment. But then if it is not legally binding, there is only an opportunity for penalty. In Hong Kong, we do not have any freedom of information law. However, we have the access to information code, even if it is not legally binding. Reporters and even ourselves, if we invoke the code of access to information and ask for information from the administration, you can refuse by saying that it is about the privacy of some people and commercial secrets, etc. And we have to make an application to a commissioner. What I find most strange is you need Mr. Toh to ask a question before you can solve my misunderstanding. Now you say you have 38.8 and 38 capital A because the device can be lost and cannot be traced. That is why you need to have this clause to give an account to the authorities. My original understanding was that under the law, the devices must be retrieved after the operation is ended. But now you say it can be lost, and that is why you have 38 capital A1A. But in fact, Mr. Toh is suggesting that there is no law to stipulate that the devices have to be retrieved. Now this is very questionable. As Mr. Toh was saying, he is from the legal sector, I'm not. But that should be a primary responsibility. You should add it back in. I am trying to emphasize the gravity of our view. Okay, the government has already said that there will be a reply. Mr. Sin Chung Kai, I was not a member of the Bills Committee when the original ordinance was scrutinized. But Mr. James Toh, you might have been negligent. You omitted that point 10 years ago. You don't have to commit suicide, but my question is, what has been happening all these 10 years? Can I please be briefed? Or is it that the devices have been self-destructing just in Mission Impossible? Did the CICS comment on this? Well, we have spent a lot of time on this already, and we haven't heard any about that. P.S. Chairman, according to CICS's reports, when LEAs do an operation of covert surveillance, they must retrieve the devices. This is what happens on the ground. The operation would mean that all devices have to be retrieved and a registration has to be entered as to the issue of such devices and the retrieval of devices. So members, you don't have to worry. All devices will be retrieved. But as I said, if a device is found broken while it is used, such odd cases would have to be reported to panel judges. And my memory tells me that there have been such cases. Well, if it breaks down, that shouldn't be a problem. Of course, you have to retrieve it. But have there been cases where devices have not been accounted for? In other words, the devices are lost and cannot be located. Chairman, I have no impression of an entire device having been lost, but I can confirm in writing. At least you need to tell me whether the commissioners have mentioned whether any devices have been unaccounted for. It's all right if a device is broken and has been retrieved. Okay, your point is made. Any other points, Mr. James Toh? Chairman, I know they still have the information, but for the sake of prudence, I will ask this question. 38A, 1A and B. The premise is bracket 1. If while a device retrieval warrant is in force but not yet completely executed, what do you mean by that premise? Have you finished with your question? PAS. Chairman, this means a warrant has been issued, but it has not been fully executed. The warrant may cover one device or a few devices. That's why under 1A, it says the devices or any of the devices specified. Maybe some devices have been retrieved, or no devices have been retrieved. Of course, if the devices have been retrieved, then you don't need to make the application. Now, can I put it this way? I don't think the devices are complicated objects. When you talk about retrieval of devices, can it be that the devices are not physical devices? Let me give you an example. I can't think back to Section 33 because I don't have it in front of me. If it is a computer virus to do monitoring, do you call that a device? My understanding is that it is. See, if I plant a virus in the computer of the chairman to monitor his activities, I'm just citing this as an example. I don't mean I set up a tab in your office, but I have planted a virus in your computer so that whatever you do will be made known to me. It is not a physical device. Do you still call it a device?
Chairman, according to the ordinance, there is a clear definition for device. It covers any equipment, apparatus, and the like, And it's also pointed out that it can be optical device, audio device, data monitoring or surveillance device, programs are also involved in the definition. Mr. To's understanding of device is a physical device, and that's also right. So his example is something that has to be retrieved. Is it? Isn't it? Say if there is a program put into the computer of the chairman, the device includes the program and also the equipment itself. Now, if it's a piece of object, say there is a piece of object, you take the piece of object out by retrieving it. But what does it mean? Do you need to destroy the program in the retrieval? And if that's the case, then it's not just retrieval. So, for example, you deactivate the program. Say the film he refers to, the thing can self-destroy. If you disable a program, does it fall within the definition of retrieval? Yes. The understanding of retrieval is a general definition, a general understanding. There is no specific definition in the bill or ordinance. If the device is put there by the LEA, then the LEA can seek authorization and retrieve that device. As for Mr. To's example, we have no special reference to that. Now you say device includes the device plus the program. My question is very straightforward. What do you mean by retrieval? If the answer is no, then I really don't know what do you mean by a retrieval that is not executed. You may need to ask the technical people to answer the question. But I really hope that you can give me an answer. If it is not something in a three-dimension space, if it is just a program, then how can you retrieve it? And if there is no further explanation on retrieval, how can you execute that retrieval? Under the circumstances, I describe how do you fit with A and B. Does it mean that the computer automatically deletes the program, or when you enter into the computer, you can't find the program? How will you do it conceptually? Okay, a written reply, please. A written reply from Mr. To. Any further questions? If not, then we move on to page 13 of the English of the Chinese version, or the page 10 of the English version, examination by commissioner, section 44. Clause 10 amends section 44 of the ordinance. 44.2a. Will be amended by adding the part marked by an arrow, the month and year from which the interception or covert surveillance began. Section 44 provides it under section 30. Anybody can apply to the commissioner under section 43 to see whether there is interception of the person himself is subject to interception of communications and surveillance unlawfully. And then when the over the page in exercise in enforcing the ordinance, if the judge or commissioner has found that there is unlawful interception, then the victim will be may be informed, and then the victim may be invited to apply for a determination by the commissioner. Now, when the person or the victim is notified, and the person has been subject to covert surveillance, the commissioner is of the view that the term duration is not clear. Say, for example, somebody is doing covert surveillance on you for half an hour, which is unlawful. The former commissioner was of the view that the duration was unclear. It should the month and year for the interception should be clarified. The purpose is this. It is to confirm within a certain period of time whether the applicant was using that communications facility. Now, the LEA was found to have breached the rule within a certain period of time. Within that period of time, would the relevant person be compensated? Then it has to be confirmed whether the person was really using that equipment or device or facility. So we need to add this provision, the month and year from which the interception or covert surveillance began. Therefore, we are to amend pages 11 and 12 on the 11 to 12. 11 and 12, rather. Why don't you specify the day, the month, and the year instead of the month and year? Mr. Chairman, we talked to the former commissioner and the current commissioner. Now, informing the relevant person or notifying the relevant person is not to notify him of the details of the operation. He is notified and a certain extent of information is provided. The operation was carried out within a certain period of time. The relevant person doesn't need to know the details of the operation. The important point is that the commissioner wants to know whether the relevant person is using that telephone, or even if he is using that telephone, he was using that telephone on that day, he might not be able to know what he was doing. So it would be good enough to know in that year, in that month, he or she was using that telephone. And the commissioner has to identify that. The commissioner has to identify the relevant person, and then the person will be invited to apply for an investigation, and then compensation will be given. Maybe I have misheard that. You say that the victim doesn't need to know. I think it is up to only the victim knows whether he needs to know or not. As for the victim, the more information, the better. He is the victim. Well, he may not need to know it exactly, the exact date. The victim wants to know the specific date. Maybe at the beginning of the month, I am in Beijing. At the end of the month, I am in New York. Now, if you are conducting surveillance on me, I really want to know what you are doing. If you refer to this month, refer to that month, then I really don't know whether you are doing surveillance on me when I was in Beijing or when I was in New York. It's not that the victim doesn't want to know the information. You cannot represent the victim. Why don't you provide more detailed information to the person? It's not that we are unwilling to provide more detailed information. The month and the year is something suggested by the commissioner, but the former commissioner, but we may consider, say, the day as well. I think you have to include the day because this person has been determined as a victim of the interception. Now, there are 31 days in a month, the longest. It makes a big difference. I asked to add the day as well. Yes, Chairman, we can consider this. We can think about it. Now, this is about the extent of the details in the notification and whether that will undermine the law enforcement effectiveness. James Tell. Now, as for Section 44, if the Commissioner is of the view that the provision of information will undermine the operation, then the Commissioner can withhold the information. At least there are some other provisions. There are provisions like this under other ordinances, under other sections. Now, if it is only relevant to the victim and it will not undermine the operation, then he should be informed. The person needs to know. Now, if we cannot assume that you did it deliberately. If that's the case, then it's a criminal case and the officer might be jailed. Say if he has made a mistake, the officer has made a mistake and has done surveillance out of line, then the victim has to know. Say, for example, in the early part of the month, I am in country A, and in the middle, country B. At the end of the month, I'm in country C. Now, if I have made a big deal at the end of the month, now you have the film. You know, the information was obtained for speculation on stocks. Now, the deal may involve billions of dollars. So the victim is afraid or is worried. So there should be mitigation measures to reduce loss. And your compensation may not be big enough, or is not big enough to cover that. A price movement in the stock may cost billions of dollars, and your compensation cannot make up for that. So he's really concerned whether people can make use of this. You really need to provide the correct or exact information to the victim. Since there are other provisions which will not undermine the operation of the LEAs, I think more information should be given in order to be fair. I think the point has been articulated clearly. Ms. Claudia Mo, when I read Section 44 initially, the ordinary person would expect the day, the month, and the year. Mr. Sin asked for even the time, at what hour. I think it's reasonable to add the day. Now in English it's a V, month and year. Can it be plural? For example, the surveillance started on the 28th of February and then ends in March. Then why can't that be the months? And yeah, should also be plural. So you do interception, you did interception in 2012, and then you did another interception in 2013. Why can't that be months and years? Why should it be singular? The PAS.
To respond to Ms. Moe. Now, when would interception or covert surveillance start? Now, that is why they use the singular form in English. But at the same time, we have not crossed out the fact that the operation is still going on. So the irregularity has to be reported and the definite time has to be given. When it has started and for how long? For 25 minutes or for 1 day, for 2 days? You have to give a duration. Ah, okay. You just said that there is a duration. But if you don't even have days, how can you talk about hours? They will go back and look at this. I think you share the views of Mr. To and Mr. Sin. Any other questions? Mr. To, I think they have to think about this as a whole. Okay, I take it that you add the word days, but if there are few durations and you have to give the information about each duration. I don't know, as it is written, even if you add the word day or days, whether you can cover different periods of time. Maybe the PAS can venture a reply. Chairman, let us go back and also respond to this and whether as written, in a case there are different irregularities, whether the different periods can be written in the same notice. Okay, no more questions. Let's go to the next page. Section 46, further provisions relating to examinations. PAS? Yes, Chairman. Clause 11 of the bill amends Section 46, bracket 3. It is a consequential amendment. So the commissioner can examine protected products. Section 46 explains that any other information included in the ordinance would be part of protected products, so it is a consequential amendment. When we come to the clause on protected product, we can come back to this clause here. Mr. James To, sorry, let me clarify first. What you mean now here is for the purpose of an examination. Let me go to the Chinese. For the purposes of an examination, the applicant is not entitled to have access to any information, document, or other matter, including any protected product, blah, blah, blah. What is your worry? You are including a new bracket because you don't want the applicant to be able to access what is included in the bracket, is that right? Well, we just want to clarify things here. In making a proposal for the commissioner to examine protected products under 53 bracket 1, the commissioner can ask anyone to let him have access to any information, document, or other matter. But we think that might not be clear enough, so we want to include protected product and also information that is or may be subject to LPP. That is in 53.1, and this is a consequential amendment. The information, document, or other matter would include protected product regardless of whether it is LPP. I can understand 53 because that is powers of the commissioner. You allow the commissioner to ask for access to anything. I understand the bracket inserted into 53 because you don't want people to have the misunderstanding that the commissioner cannot get access to something, so you want to state it clearly. But here it is different. You are talking about the applicant. The applicant may not have the power to access this and that, so he should not have the authorization to access anything. What I mean is you don't need the bracket because he will not have access to any information, document or other matter. Of course, he will not have access to protected product either. So I find this a little strange. Okay, he is not going to have any access to anything. And what is your worry? Why are you worried that the things inside the bracket may be made available to the applicant? What is the foundation or basis for your worry? PAS, the basis for our concern is that under 53.1A, the former CICS was worried that as written, it doesn't include protected products. So we have found that the construction is the same here, and that is why we want to have consistency. We want to add protected product to information, document, or other matter. This is really branching out from the amendment to 53.1A. Mr. To, you mean the bracket is not needed? I just can't understand this. 53A1, you say any. Unless we query that certain things are not included. But under the new mechanism, the commissioner should be able to examine anything. And for the sake of clarity and to play safe, you add the bracket to it. Now, is it that if you have the bracket in 53.1A but not in 46.3, will it be that the applicant will be able to get access to information subject to LPP? I think that is not possible. Your basis is that if there is the bracket in 53.1A, you need it here. They are strengthening it, said the chairman. But I would ask you to be careful. I think you need to run through this again. If we have this in 46 and 53.1A, because you say if you are worried, if it is not added, then nothing will be exempted. Then if that is the case, then you have to run through the entire ordinance again, because this small change would trigger a new regime. Maybe the legal advisor can say something, and then I would allow Mr. Ken to speak. Let me try to assist members, but of course the administration can further add after me. As the administration said, we may refer to page 14 of the English version to have a glance of 53.1A. They are including a bracket to say information, document or other matter would include protected product or anything subject to LPP. What Mr. To is saying that even if there is not this bracket, 46 would mean this is already included. But the interpretation by Mr. To would also apply to 53.1A. So the logic of the administration is that since the CICS has mentioned in previous report his views, they think they need the amendment in 53.1A so that even if there is information subject to LPP, the commissioner should be able to examine it. If that is the basis, then the original reading of 53.1A would mean that this was not included. That is why the administration was saying this is a consequential amendment. Since they want to have this amendment for 53.1A, they need to do the same for 46. maybe the administration can further add. Mr. Kan. Thank you, Chairman. This is a technical amendment. The first one is in 53.1A. It authorizes the commissioner to examine protected product which is subject to LPP. Because of the amendment in 53.1A, 46.3 should have this consequential technical amendment to state that any information would include information subject to LPP. We are doing this for the sake of consistency. This is a drafting technique. And also because we have 53(4), should also have this as a consequential amendment. Because 46(3) mentions 53(4). This is a technical amendment. Ms. Claudia Mo. Thank you, Chairman. A minor question. This doesn't have anything to the new addition. I'm talking about 46(4A). Give reasons for his determination. Shall not give reasons for his determination. In English, you use the word determination, and I was trying to find the Chinese translations for the word determination on Google. But in Chinese, you have gone for the words 斷定. It sounds a little negative. Why have you gone for the term 斷定 and not 決定, Mr. Kan? Have you got the question? Or Ms. Monica Law? Thank you, Chairman. The word or term 決定 may not be appropriate. We have used the term 斷定 for determination in other ordinances as well. Maybe I can cite you the examples for your reference. Maybe 裁定 or 裁決 would sound better, because 斷定 sounds like an emotional decision. Ms. Law, will you consider this view? Will you consider using the term 裁定 instead of 斷定? We have used 裁定 for other words in English. My impression is that determination is always rendered as 斷定, and 裁定 can sometimes be the translation of other English words. Mr. James Toh, I still like to get to the bottom of 46(3). It says, without prejudice to section 53(4), the applicant will not be able to gain access to such and such. And 53(4) just doesn't say that the applicant can have access to such. So why in 46(3) you start with without prejudice to 53(4). Well, I've been following the discussion, and I feel that the commissioner would like this to be added in. No, that's not what I mean. Chairman, if you look at 53(4), it doesn't have relationship to 46(3) at all. On the contrary, I have to think very hard on why 46(3) should start with without prejudice to section 53(4), PAS. Thank you, Chairman and Mr. Toh. 53(4) talks about the commissioner not being required to produce in any court or any person any information, document, or matter compiled by or made available to him in the course of performing his functions, a non-disclosure clause. And the relationship is such that in 46(3), we talk about whether the applicant can try to access the information related to his case. And here we state clearly, without prejudice to section 53(4), the applicant doesn't have that authority. No, you remember, if in 53.4 it says the applicant can get information, then in 46(3) you provide for exemptions, then you can have the line without prejudice to section 53.4.
But it doesn't say the applicant can get the information. I know that's in the original provision of the ordinance, but I don't understand why. In the ordinance, 53.4 has nothing to do with the applicant entirely. He doesn't have the power. Why you say you put down here that he has no power? Because the law has already said that it has no power. He has no power. Are you referring to something else? Or was it a mistake originally? The commissioner has to report to him, has to give account, an account to him. Well, there is no mistake in the original version. They are related. The commissioner, in doing the examination, he has possession of certain confidential information. The law also says that with regard to interception of communications, it cannot be put before the court as evidence. It's not admissible in the court. 53.4 spells out this clearly. 53.1a said that he could obtain information from anybody, and he has no need to disclose it to anybody. Now, if an applicant writes to the commissioner, you say that my application cannot be approved, you have to explain to me. The law, therefore, provides clearly that the commissioner doesn't need to provide the information to the applicant. So the consistency is here. I don't know whether you're considering this. 53.1a says the commissioner may require any public officer or any other person to blah, blah, blah. Assuming that the commissioner obtains information, LPP information, from the applicant. That person, the applicant, will have to provide information. After the person has provided the information, then that person has lost the information afterwards. And then there is the examination, section 46. Now he told the commissioner, I gave you the information, but now I have lost the information. Can you give that information back to me? The commissioner says, no, I can't, because under 46.3. You may say that's rather weird type of argument. I don't know whether you are considering this. Otherwise, I really can't think of any other reason for that. Now I have jumped the gun. 53A, the any public officer or any other person does mean the applicant as well. Any other person means any other person. The commission, of course, can obtain information from the relevant person, any other person, the applicant, the public officer, the panel judge, for information. Any other person does cover the applicant. Concerning the assumption made by Mr. Toh, is it because of a certain special reason the information is lost, and then therefore that person goes to the commissioner and asks for the information? If he has given the information to the commissioner, then theoretically speaking, if he wants to get that piece of information back from the commissioner, that should be permitted. But for 46.3, that will not be entertained. Now, if the information is obtained from the public officer, then from a public officer, then the piece of information cannot be given to the applicant. But you really need to explain to me why 53 and 46 are related. And any other person can cover the applicant, and the applicant has given you the information, and then later he lost the information. Then he wants to get the information back from the commissioner. Then the commissioner will deny that request, because the commissioner cannot give the information to the person, the applicant. Mr. Khan. Well, I tried to explain 46.3 and 53.4. Is made up of two parts. Except as otherwise provided in this ordinance, the commissioner shall not be required to produce in any court, blah, blah, blah. And last sentence, or to provide or disclose to any person information, any document or other matter compiled, blah, blah, blah. If you look at 46.3, it deals with the applicant, whether the applicant has the power to have access to the information. 46.3 says no. 46.3 makes reference to without prejudice subsection 3.4. It says that it is because there may be the question of whether any other person has the power except the applicant. And that's why the provision spells out clearly that the commissioner doesn't have the obligation to provide information. 53.4. Other than provided for in the ordinance, where are the other provisions? 53.4. If there is no other provision requiring the provision of information by the commissioner, then starting right at the start of 46, the commissioner doesn't need to provide information. There is no misunderstanding. Now, if you include the applicant under any other person, and that person has lost the information after he gave the information to the commissioner, and he now wants to get the information from the commissioner, therefore the commissioner under 46.3 cannot provide information. I think that's unfair. That may be too technical. So I just want to know what do you mean by otherwise provided in this ordinance? What are the other things provided in this ordinance are in your mind? What do you mean by that? What other provisions are there? There is nothing. And why you still add this in? There is nothing out there. And now you want to add there is nothing in the provision. And that caused a doubt in Mr. Toh's mind. You really need to answer that. All right. Shall we move on? Yes. 53A. Yes, the day, the month, the year, and the time. I asked for the day, not the time. Okay, page 16 of the markup copy. That's also in relation to notification. It is, yes, PAS. That's page 13 of the English version. Now it's in relation to clause or section 48. It's about notification. If it is found that there is unauthorized operation, then the relevant person has to be informed. The former commissioner is of the view that the definition of relevant person is not adequate. If you look at page 13 of the English version, section subsection 7, in this section, relevant person means any person who is the subject of the interception or covert surveillance concerned. The victim is the subject. The former commissioner is of the view that the definition is not very clear, therefore on the right-hand side, under the triangle, we clarify the issue. What do we mean by relevant person? There are three sub-clauses, A, B, and C. Under the circumstances of unauthorized operation, three types of persons will be affected. If the interception or covert surveillance concerned is one that is continued after the prescribed authorization concern or the relevant part of the prescribed authorization concern has ceased to have any effect, the subject of the interception or covert surveillance. Originally, there was an authorization, but the authorization ceased to have effect, and yet the surveillance continues. Then, as for B, if the interception or covert surveillance concern is carried out by an officer of the department concerned purportedly pursuant to a prescribed authorization, but the subject of the interception of covert surveillance is not the intended subject under that prescribed authorization, the subject of the interception or covert surveillance. Under B, there was prescribed authorization, but the subject was wrong. That's when the person became a victim. C, if the interception or covert surveillance concerned is carried out without the authority of a prescribed authorization, no application had been made, then the subject of that operation is the relevant person. Originally, we used the term any person who is the subject, and now we spell out the details. There's three conditions under which the subject is considered to be the relevant person, and then the commissioner will have to notify that person. I know that authorization has ceased to have effect. A and B, I understand this. But what about C, a wrong subject? Maybe you can give me an example. Is it a wrong identification or what? Yes, a PAS. An example. Earlier on, there was an authorization, say a number of a telecommunication device. When doing the import, a wrong number was put into. Say the approval is 1234567, and then the input is 1234568. There was an authorization, but the number was wrong. The LEA was asked to, or the LEAs were asked to do checking. Authorization was given, but the number was wrong. Or the wrong line. Or the line was wrong. Say, a wrong identification of the person. That's too general. It's too general. For example, 123456. The number is 123456 for surveillance. Now you want to survey, to conduct covert surveillance on person called Mr. Wing. But the number has been given to another person instead of this Mr. Wing. The intended subject should be a person instead of a number. Concerning Mr. To's example, if the subject is a Mr. Wing, and then the application was about him, but when doing the listening in, it was another person. Then that is under B. The intended subject is Mr. Wing, but the subject listened to is another person. Maybe the number, the telephone has been given to another person. If the it is not the intended subject, then it's B.
Any questions? To sum up, A, B, and C are to cover who the subject is in more detail. We might not be able to exhaust the different categories of persons, but the CICS has already written a few reports. However, we can only read the reports and we may not know all the details. Well, I remember what you said, but is it that you have already covered all categories of persons? Well, at least from experience, do you think you have already covered all different categories of people as you know it now? Thank you, Chairman. We thought about this for a long time, and the former CICS also thought about that for a long time, and I believe these three categories would have covered everyone. Ms. Claudia Mo, like to pursue a minor point. Mr. To painted a scenario. You would like to intercept Wing, instead you intercepted Bill. So it's clear a mistake. But what if the number, telephone number, is correct? It is just that the number is used by the husband or wife of that person, and yet the intercepted material is very usable. So what are you going to do? PAS, the LEA must act according to the prescribed authorization. If it is about a telephone number, the LEA has to justify why a certain number is to be intercepted. He has to state who is using that number, even if it's not a real person's name, but a person's nickname used in criminal activities, then that has to be stated. However, if upon the start of the operation, it is found that the number is no longer used by the intended subject, then the LEA would have to make an immediate report to the panel judge. Okay, if there are no other questions, we go on. 53. I think we have touched upon that previously, or just now. PAS, thank you, Chairman. This is about further powers of Commissioner. This is to, we end our meeting at 10:45. I'm watching the time. We started at 10:45. Sorry. Please continue. Thank you, Chairman. This amendment is to empower the Commissioner to examine protected product and to add 53A. So the CICS can delegate his power to his office and people working in his office. So we amend 53(1)(a) that the Commissioner can require any public officer or any other person to answer any question and to provide any information, document, or other matter in his possession or control to the Commissioner within the time and in the manner specified by the Commissioner when making the requirement. And we are inserting a bracket to include any protected product, whether or not it contains any information that is or may be subject to legal professional privilege. This is to state clearly that the Commissioner can examine material that can be subject to LPP, because the former CICS felt that he would need that power because it would represent a deterrent against LEA's possible contraventions, and so that the Commissioner can look into all such suspected contraventions. 53(a) delegation. 1. The Commissioner may delegate in writing the power specified in subsection 2 to an officer working in the Commissioner's office who is responsible to the Commissioner. 2. The power is the power to examine protected products provided to the Commissioner in compliance with the requirement imposed under section 53(1)(a). This is to state clearly what that power is. And number 3, The Commissioner may specify in any instrument of delegation any terms or conditions subject to which the delegation is to have effect. So he can set terms or conditions. And number four, a delegation under this section does not preclude the Commissioner from exercising at any time the power so delegated. This is based on the views of former CICS and the incumbent CICS. Members, Mr. To. Number one, sorry, give me a moment. Why do you use the words who is responsible to the commissioner? Why don't you just state public officer? You have to remember your powers are those in 53.1a, and especially now you also give them the power to examine protected product, which may be subject to LPP. You have to be very careful. Of course, the power can be given to the commissioner, but then you say a person who is responsible to the commissioner. Who are these people? In previous meetings, we have talked about discipline, people, translators. I think this one here is not precise enough. You mentioned the same question last time. You say that the material should not be given to a translator, that the commissioner should only hand it to a person he wants to appoint. I think you have to have a very clear system for showing responsibility. Or else we can only trust the commissioner who can appoint these people. Are you saying it must be a civil servant? Well, I don't know. You have to understand. This is a very high level that we are talking about. You are raising the question. Please state your view clearly. I am just citing an example. Because the administration is drafting this clause on delegation of power, and I believe you must have a lot of experience in drafting similar provisions. To me, when you say who is responsible to the commissioner, I think you are going for the easy way out. Perhaps you can be more specific so that we are reassured. PAS. Thank you, Chairman. We are saying that it can be delegated to an officer working in the commissioner's office who is responsible to the commissioner. So we are setting limitations. Of course, the commissioner will not delegate the power to anybody in the office. It must be for people who are responsible to the commissioner. In the end, the commissioner may delegate the power to persons A, B, and C, but they are responsible to the commissioner. In other words, the commissioner has the responsibility to supervise them. Even if the power is delegated to them, when the three persons assist the commissioner in making further examination of protected products, they are responsible to the commissioner. So we have already narrowed the parameters. Legal advisor. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to assist the Bills Committee. The drafting is that the Commissioner may delegate the power to an officer working in the Commissioner's office who is responsible to the Commissioner. Roughly speaking, it may be any person in the office because they're all responsible to the Commissioner. But the policy intent of the administration is that it will not be just any person in the office. It will not be a clerk or a secretary. These people may be people who are directly responsible to the commissioner or who are comparatively high ranking. I think Mr. To's concern is that you should tighten up the drafting to state more clearly who are the people who can be delegated the power. Thank you. PAS, any supplement? Chairman, can I now let you know the structure of the Commissioner's office to assist your understanding. Right now, these are all civil servants who are in the office. Only those who are comparatively high-ranking can come into contact with confidential information. They are executive officers, the Secretary General is a PEO, Principal Executive Officer, and under him there are senior executive officers and EO1 and EO2. That is the structure, organization, chart of the office. These people assist the Commissioner in making daily examinations. When it comes to delegation of power, I'm sure the Commissioner will only delegate power to a handful of high-ranking officers who have the need for that power, and these are also civil servants. So basically, you agree with the legal advisor, is that right? Ms. Claudia Mo, sorry, Chairman, can I continue? Do you mean directly responsible? Only the most high-ranking? Are you talking about the Secretary General? I don't know how many senior officers there are. Do you mean only the few senior officers? PAS, structure-wise, well, it is a monitoring organization. And to assist the Commissioner, we have one PEO, and under him or her, there are a few SEOs. And SEOs will also supervise EOs. They are in the same structure as in government departments. No, Mr. Tu is asking you whether the delegation of power will only go to the most high-ranking officers. Will it stop at the level of SEO, for example? Is my understanding correct, Mr. Tu? Well, yes. I think it must be the most high-ranking two or three. Thank you, Chairman. We understand that the office has already applied for resources, that if the Legislative Council will grant the power of further examination, there will be the adding of a few posts, including one senior EO and a few EO2s. Oh, you mean EO1? EO1 is not high-ranking at all. EO1? I thought you would stop at SEO. Or Ms. Claudia Mo, well, for the sake of clarity, I don't think you can put down EO1 or EO2. Why don't you just say directly responsible to the Commissioner so that we would not be seen to be rank conscious? Let us say for sure that these would not include dispatch people, for example. Why can't you add the word directly responsible? DS, let me add Chairman. Within the organization chart mentioned by Mrs. Ng, those who are directly responsible to the Commissioner, we only have the Secretary General. But as Mrs. Ng said, under the Secretary General, we have SEOs and other EOs. In fact, in the entire structure assists the Commissioner. In the end, it's up to the Commissioner to decide who he will delegate the power for accessing protected products. In fact, our understanding is that it will be limited to the highest level or the few levels, and he will limit it to the smallest number, which is practically reasonable. But this can be interpreted as the necessity arises. But I understand the Commissioner has not decided how the actual operation will be. Mr. Toh asked whether EO1 would be too low a rank. In fact, we have the same concern. And we have found, actually, that within LEAs, the listening team is made up of inspector rank officers. And the executive officer grade and the entry point may tally with the pay scale of inspectors, and in fact senior EOs rank higher than inspectors. So we think it should be safe. But later on, we will come to this point. There must be a written delegation, not just oral delegation.
And the commissioner will set out the conditions and restrictions. Chairman, a final short question. I'm not familiar with legal terms. The Chinese give us the impression, Chinese version gives us the impression that there will be more than one. But in English, it is an officer. Will you change it? Will you use the term any officer, which will be safer? In English, it's just singular. It seems that there is only one person. Yes, maybe the law draftsman can explain. Well, maybe we'll start here next time. Just a sentence. I think EO1. I don't know why such a ranking is given the power. But after all, it's a disciplined force. The training is different from the civilians. If you give the power to an EO1, I'm not comfortable. Sorry. You say it should be senior, more senior. Well, then you need more funding. Well, we can reflect the view of Mr. Tao to the commissioner. I hope the commissioner will consider this. This may have a bearing on whether we amend this provision or not. Right. Now the view has been given and the administration will come back on this point. At the, when shall we start at the next meeting? Have we finished studying this? No, not yet, Mr. Chairman. Okay, we'll start here again. Okay, the Bills Committee meeting is now adjourned. Date of next meeting, 23rd of October, 8:30 a.m. 23rd of October.